From WABE in Atlanta, I'm Lois Reitzes, and this is City Lights. We'll hear about music from unexpected points of view today. Conductor Marie Sidlin will lead a concert titled Hours of Freedom, with music composed by prisoners at Terezin, the Nazi concentration camp near Prague. First, a new take on bending notes. Mezzo-soprano Jamie Barton is adored throughout the world. Opera magazine has said she has a once-in-a-generation voice, and the New York Times calls her a rock star, along with accolades too long to list here. In Georgia, we call Miss Jamie our own. Jamie is also an activist on behalf of women and members of the LGBTQ community. She's taken her conscience raising to the stage with a feminist recital program, and Spivey Hall is the next stop on that tour. Ahead of her Spivey recital on Sunday, Jamie Barton joins us in studio now. Welcome back to City Lights.
Thank you so much for having me.
Oh, how great to have you here. Now, Jamie, I think the last time you were here, you were playing the role of Sister Helen.
Indeed, indeed. I think I was in the studio with Sister Helen, actual Sister Helen.
The actual Sister Helen, who is a saint, although she said, "Don't you be talking about no sainthood for me." Those were her exact words. Yours was an astonishing performance in the Atlanta Opera's Dead Man Walking, and the production was superb. If you will, would you fill us in on a few of the highlights of what you've been doing in the month since?
Oh my gosh. So that was January and February of this last year. Since then, I went on to sing Fricka, the queen of the gods, I would call her.
I would say that fits.
Yes, yes, at the Metropolitan Opera in their massive production of The Ring. I had a wonderful time in San Francisco this last summer, getting to reprise my role as Yeji Baba in Rusalka. I had a really fun time actually putting together a concert piece called When There Are Nine, which was a piece written about Ruth Bader Ginsburg at the Cabrillo Festival. She actually sent us a video thanking us for putting that on, which was incredible. I went to the proms.
Yeah, we'll get to that later. Jamie was a prom date of the highest order.
I like to call myself the prom queen.
You were that.
which was an incredible experience. I mean, the last night of the proms is, as I've put it before, is something that I knew of before I actually kind of knew what the proms were. It's a big party, and everybody's invited, and I got to be the ringmaster.
Well, it is also usually reserved for artists who are older than you.
Yes. Honestly, it was a gigantic surprise that they asked me to do this. I've watched as my colleagues of future, you know, later generations have done it. I've known Joyce DiDonato and Sarah Connolly and all these people who I just have looked up to for as long as I've been singing. And so when they came and asked me if I would do it, I kind of looked behind my shoulder and said, "Are you talking to me?"
Oh, but you pulled it off. And it is such pride of place to host that, to be the queen of the proms or whatever sovereign you want to be. And what came through again was your fabulous sense of humor and humility. And you looked so gorgeous in that sparkly dress, and you pulled off the cabaret. And once again, you're just everyone's BFF. Now, you did have a stint at the Met recently, too.
Yes, I did. I got to do my very first title role at the Met, as well as my very first pants role, which is, in layman's terms, I got to be a drag king at the Met.
This is complicated, if you could fill listeners in a little bit, because some people may know about castrati. Mm-hmm. That horrible, that inhumane, what would you call it, practice, yes. I guess, which enabled men to sing with the power of the strongest soprano in the 18th century.
Yeah.
But, you know, Shakespeare, men played women. Mm-hmm. Here you are, a woman playing the man. What's the history with this role playing in Orfeo?
So it's really cool, and I'll truncate it as much as possible, but way back in the day, long story short, the Pope and the Vatican decided that women shouldn't be on stage. And so castrati began to be a thing where they would take young boys who had very promising musical talent and they would castrate them, mm-hmm. which is horrific. But this was a practice that went on for a couple of hundred years. Castrati back in their time were the modern day rock stars. They were the Freddie Mercurys of their time. And a lot of the appeal was because of the oddity of what would happen with their bodies and their voices. But what would happen with their voices, because they were castrated, their voices would stay in that kind of soprano kind of place for the rest of their lives. It would get stronger because they were graduating from being young boys into men. But so these roles for a lot of the beginning of opera were written for castrati to sing. Well, when the practice went away, they had to have people fill those roles. And as it happens, mezzo-sopranos, for the most part, some sopranos as well, but mezzo-sopranos were really the voice type that fit into those roles. And so they kind of flipped it on its head. And mezzos began dressing as men on stage to play these roles. And so Orfeo, the role that I played at the Met, is one of those roles. It was written really for almost a male alto, one of the lower kind of castrati. A lot of the castrati roles are actually a little on the higher side for my particular voice type. But this one fits rather like a glove, a very low and lovely glove.
Well, we have a clip, and we want to hear Jamie Barton as Orfeo at the Met. Let's listen to this now. I want to quote this review. It begins with apologies to Gluck. Where would we be without mezzo Jamie Barton in the revival of Mark Morris's production of Orpheus and Eurydice at the Met? Barton, who has shown herself to be indispensable in repertoire from Bellini to Wagner to Hegi, took on her first title role and pants role at the Met and showed her breadth of vitality as a singer, along with the velvet in her voice. How does that not get to you, Jamie?
Oh my gosh. Quite honestly, it does. It's lovely hearing this. I actually do, in general, stay away from reading reviews and that sort of thing. But it's always quite lovely when I hear a really lovely one like that.
Yes, I understand why performers don't want to read reviews, but in this case, I think you deserve to hear that.
Thank you.
Now, we are sandwiched in between your recital at Wigmore Hall.
Yes.
And another date in San Francisco. You're performing Sunday at Spivey Hall. It's billed as a feminist recital. Would you tell us, what is a feminist recital?
Well, to me, truly, I became really, really interested in the idea of a feminist approach to a recital because I like the idea of equality between the sexes. And really, when I looked back at all of my studies, I could name hundreds of male composers, hundreds of male poets, and I really couldn't do the same with women. And I knew, of course, I've been singing, one of the groups that I'm singing on this recital is a group by Libby Larson. She's a contemporary composer. I have loved this group. I've sung it for 12 years. And it just, to me, it was a moment where I was like, you know, we could really celebrate women, the genius of women, women not just being muses for the genius of men, but women in their own creative genius coming forward, both in the words and in the music. And so with my collaborator, Kathy Kelly, we really began to dig because, quite honestly, once again, I just didn't know what was out there. And so we put together a recital that is really just about 50-50, men and women, the equality of the sexes together on stage, the genius of both sexes together on stage, in celebration of the female perspective. And I'm telling you, we've been touring this recital off and on for about 3 years now, and it has gotten just a wonderful response everywhere it's gone.
We're here with mezzo-soprano Jamie Barton. So you were telling us about this wonderful idea of feminist recital program, and we're going to hear a little bit from the selections you'll perform. Let's listen to one of those Libby Larson songs. This is Blonde Man. And unfortunately, we don't have you, but I should say, it's never unfortunate to hear Suzanne Metzer.
At all.
Who said blondes have more fun? Okay, we're listening to one of the songs that make up Love After 1950, that torch song by Libby Larson, Blonde Man. Now, what can you tell us about Big Sister Says?
Oh, man. Each one of these songs in Love After 1950s is done in a different style. This one, I believe, is marked as a honky-tonk.
Love it.
Which the first piano entrance is so Jerry Lee Lewis, it's not even funny. It's just so much fun. And it's basically talking about, you can tell it's a little sister, and her big sister, Beryl, has been saying, you know, beauty hurts. You're going to have to pluck your eyebrows. You're going to have to shave. And so this younger sister is having this moment of, you know, not feeling comfortable with the cost of beauty. And then by the end of it, she sees the result of her finding her own beauty in this sort of socialized way. And by the end of it, you know, beauty hurts, turns into less of a, oh no, beauty hurts, into more of a beauty hurts. Okay, sure.
Well, let's hear some of Big Sister Says.
Beauty hurts.
But it doesn't hurt to listen to that. What a fabulous description of the pianist entrance. That is pure Jerry Lee Lewis. You need to take this to Memphis.
I would be happy to.
The last clip we have is Boy's Lips, a blues style song. This poem is by the great Rita Duff. Mm. We only have a minute, but let's hear just a bit. Blues, a la Rita Dove, mm-hmm. with that music of Libby Larson, mezzo-soprano Jamie Barton, who, when 30-some years ago, a star was born in Georgia, it was you. Oh. Jamie, what a delight, and that you, with all your glamorous globe-trotting stops, you still want to come home to perform for us.
Oh, it's always a pleasure. I always look forward to it. And Spivey Hall is just, what a gem of a place. It's going to be a wonderful, wonderful Sunday, I believe.
Mezzo-soprano and Georgia's own gem, Jamie Barton, with pianist Kathleen Kelly, perform their feminist recital at Spivey Hall Sunday afternoon at 3:00. You're listening to City Lights. Jamie, bravo, and thank you.
Thank you.